Hi, I'm Dr. Brannick Riggs, Vice President of Education at doTERRA International. And I'm here with Dr. Ruth Dempsey from our Scientific and Medical Education Committee. And we're excited to be talking to you today about Shinrin-Yoku. Exciting new blend that we have. Pretty excited about this. So tell us about the activity of Shinrin-Yoku or forest bathing, Ruth.
Oh, yes. Well, with pleasure. Well, as you and I had talked about for many, many years, you know, we all, I think, or many of us really instinctively enjoy being out in nature. Yeah. And being out particularly in the forest. I have forest around about me and I've always loved going out and walking in the forest. And I always felt energized by going into the forest. And so I started to question why a forest in particular, about, you know, the freshness of the oxygen, because you've got all the trees and stuff around. Mm-hmm. And that's when I really started first taking an interest in it. And heard about the idea of forest bathing, of actually using the forest to actually help people, mm-hmm. which comes from the term Shinrin-Yoku, mm-hmm. which was actually created in Japan. Not that long ago, actually. I mean, right. It was 1982. I think it was the Ministry of Agriculture, Fisheries and Food.
For you and I, not that long ago.
Okay. <sure. laughs> Okay. I would not call it, let's not term ancient art. So. Because I was well in my 20s by then. But yeah, so the Ministry of Agriculture, Fisheries and Food started to propose the idea of countering the stresses and anxiety that was being caused by living in urban environments in Japan by encouraging people to go out and walk into the forests. Yeah. And that's where the sort of the idea of forest bathing as an activity, as a therapy, if you like, actually started in Japan. Although we've been doing it a lot longer beforehand. Yeah. And they started to realize the benefits from it. In fact, they set up a research center in Japan to support it and to look into all the things that this sort of going out into the forest could do to, as I said, to counter a lot of the negative effects that come from living so constantly in an unnatural environment. Mm-hmm. I mean, that our bodies are created to be in nature.
Absolutely. Our genes were adapted through nature,
yes.
Not through cities.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. And the explosion of cities has happened much quicker than our genes can adapt to. Mm-hmm. It takes a long time to sort of readapt to that environment. And even if you don't live in the city, the stressful life that is associated with current living practices, mm-hmm. puts our bodies under an awful lot of stress. And I think the encouragement for people to go out into nature is a natural, instinctive way to deal with the stresses that our bodies are having. And when you actually look at the impact that it has, not just the sort of subjective impact, but you can actually objectively measure differences that are happening to the body when you go out and disconnect and go into the environment.
Yeah, so what we instinctively feel in that environment is now objectively measured to say, yeah. Our bodies and our physiology do change and does yeah. change when we are out in that natural environment.
Absolutely, absolutely. Yeah. I always think it's kind of a shame that you need to have those measurements, but that's where we, as human beings, that's where we are now. You know, we've lost right. that trust in our instincts and it's, well, why do I feel better? I need to know that I have a measurement that makes me feel better.
Right.
You feel better.
What are the steps to forest bathing? What are the
that's
the
a, that's a very that interesting do? Thing about it. The forest bathing as a practice itself involves, first of all five senses. Mm-hmm. That's an important element of it. Mm-hmm. But the first thing is, it isn't just go in the forest, come back, you know, oh, I've got to fit my 5-minute forest bathing in. You right. really do have to disconnect. That's an extremely important part of it. You have to stop what you're doing, break your routines, go into nature somewhere and immerse yourself in that natural environment. So that's the first step, if you like, is really making that break. Mm-hmm. Ideally, you want to spend enough time to completely engage within the forest, to touch the forest, to sense it. A very good friend of mine who always used to say when he was feeling bad, he'd go into the forest, he'd lean against a tree, he would take his shoes off and put his feet into the earth. And there's something about that really physically engaging with it that makes yeah. you feel sort of complete. Mm-hmm. So that's a sort of the touch sense. Obviously all the colors, the natural colors you have, you know, from seeing it, You can feel it, and you can hear. I mean, forests, is it birds? Is it the rustle of the trees, you know, the leaves in the trees? Any time of the year, the crunch as you're walking through, you know, hearing all those senses, really enveloping yourself in that is a very important part of it, because it triggers and stimulates all those parts of the body that helps then for you to disengage completely and to relax. And that takes time. Start thinking of different things. A great thing to do in the forest is to go and meditate. Just to sit in a quiet spot in the forest and meditate. One of the things that I like to do in the forest is to choose a tree that's your tree. We talked about this mother trees. There are trees that are more important than other trees in the forest, for the forest itself. It actually is a community, and it supports itself together. So connecting with a tree really makes a difference. All this is really calming down your nervous system. That's what we're basically doing, is it's you're engaging with nature, calming down your nervous system, making yourself feel connected to nature again. So reboosting the body in a way that you can. As long as you have the time to do that, then the most important thing, of course, is to remember is to transition calmly back to life.
Yeah, that third step.
Yeah, because it's not just a tick box, I've done this and I go back. You need to take that experience back with you into your daily routines, into what you're doing back at home. So that's the benefit that you get from it. So it's three basically major steps to it. Mm-hmm. Break off, do something different, take as much time as you can to really use all of your senses in there, and then disengage, but go back, transition back, taking everything with you.
Yeah, the research tells us somewhere between 10 and 20 minutes is maybe the minimum time to get some effect on the human system, and can be up to a few hours.
Well, the original research that was done was basically taking people out for 2 or 3 days into a forest environment, and then they would go out for 2 hours in the morning and 2 hours in the afternoon and come back in again. That's, you know, most of us, I'm guessing, are not going to be able to do that.
So, but what if we can't? What if we can't spend 2 hours in the morning and 2 hours in the afternoon every day? Because I'll be honest, my schedule doesn't allow for that. Really, I would love for it to, but it doesn't allow for that. So what if we can't make it to the forest every day?
Well, is there something that obviously, as you said, first of all, even a small amount helps. Every part helps. Mm-hmm. But the other thing is that you can bring all those practices that I just talked about, you can bring to you. Mm-hmm. So disengaging is an important part. This is all part of meditation and mindfulness and doing that. So you can always do those sort of things at home. And contacting nature in any way that you can, be it going into your garden, having sort of plants in the home, or just embracing the thought of nature. In fact, there's even some studies that have been done on actually playing videos of forests or fish tanks or animals and things round about, having that connection that you can do. So you can recreate as many of those sensorial elements as you can back in the home. And of course, one of the senses that I didn't mention beforehand is, of course, the sense of smell. So bringing those aromas from the forest back in is an extremely important part of it. Actually, I'll mention as an aside, there was some interesting research done on looking at whether it was the forest or whether it was just going into nature. And so some of these studies have looked at, for example, a forest compared to a field. And you get benefits from disconnecting and going into a field, you clearly do.
Sure.
But particularly in the summer months, you get a significantly higher benefit from the forests. I'm talking about deciduous forests here, obviously.
Right.
And this is one of the things that led them to realize that actually, if you actually sample the air in the forest, there are elements within the forest itself that contribute to that sense of smell and the well-being that you get, that feeling of well-being that you get out of it.
Yeah, isn't that cool?
It is. And you'll never guess what they are. Of course, they're essential oils.
Right.
Yeah.
Breathing out some of that chemistry, right?
That's their trees are plants. Trees
those
are plants.
The and alpha pinene, beta pinene, linalool.
The cassette,
right? Limonene, 1,8-cineol. These are things we're familiar with in the essential oil world.
Exactly.
And it's amazing to me that what the trees are breathing out, as we breathe in, we settle into normalcy. We settle into homeostasis, right? It's pretty amazing.
I think it's wonderful, yes.
And yeah. So we have our Shinrin-Yoku blend.
Yes, yes. I can stop fiddling around with Siberian fir and Enoki in my own back
mixing
kitchen.
Mixing it all,
yeah,
right?
I can do that. Yeah.
Tell us about the Shinrin-Yoku blend.
It's a beautiful blend with all those elements that we talked about with the phytoncides mm-hmm. within there. These are what they call... I don't know why they feel like they have to give a name to it, but they call them phytoncides because these are the ones that come from the plants in the forest, and that's what we're inhaling. And these are the basic elements that come from the essential oils. Like, as you said, this is what they call the 1-8-cineal cassette, which is the alpha pinenes, beta pinenes, limonene, linalool, amongst sort of other things. Mm-hmm. It's a beautiful blend because I've always thought I focus on the trees. So I've always focused on the tree oils, on hinoki, which I think is lovely when you can get it, Siberian fir. And what this one does is it really combines that with some of the citrus oils, which I thought at first was a really interesting one. But of course, the limonene is an extremely important part. The elements of the essential oils that come from the citrus fruits are a very important part of the forest bathing experience as well.
Right.
So, you know, Ed, this is just a beautifully balanced blend that has all these elements in there, which brings the smells of the forest, the essential oils that are in the forest, brings them into a little tiny bottle.
Yeah, it's interesting that we don't commonly associate, like for instance, citrus and a forest, particularly a conifer forest or an evergreen forest. We don't make that association because the two don't, they're not around each other. We go to citrus, which is in warmer, you know, climates, and then we go to the forest, which is typically in cooler climates. But yet those trees in those forest environments are bringing some of the citrus chemistry in
exactly.
with them.
Yeah.
They have some of the, even some of the floral chemistry of linalool. Yeah. The trees are still emitting some linalool as well, which we typically think of floral, lavender, those sorts of things. But yet those trees
I mean, forests
have.
Are a very complex environment, so it's no surprise right. that it's not just what comes from the trees that contribute right. to the environment.
So how do you recommend using Shinrin-Yoku?
The objective here is to bring the beauty of being in the forest into your environment on a convenient way. So, you know, these particular blends are, you know, you can just rub it in your hands when you need to. Use it in a meditation, I think, you know, to combine it with the natural experiences of disconnecting is a useful way that you could do it. Some of the research studies talk about how you can expose yourself for periods of time to these particular essential oil components. Expose yourself to it in a way that simulates what you would get from the office.
Yeah.
From the office.
From the forest.
Not from the office.
Right.
Unless you have a very forest-based office.
Right. So you could expose yourself to the blend and do a meditation, or perhaps do, there's guided meditations, there's visual meditations that we've talked about before.
Oh, yes.
Visualization of a forest, right? Or even just being around your house plants, right?
Yes.
Being around those,
going in the garden.
Chemistry.
Yeah. Doing a bit of weeding.
So has there been any studies on this type of blend?
Oh, yes. Well, I mentioned there's a research institute in that was set up in Japan that has done, I think, some really, really good studies. You know, asking all these questions, is a field as good as a forest? You know, and then investigating what happens with that. But actually, there's been more and more organizations worldwide, the institutes worldwide that started looking into it. And there has been some really interesting research bringing the essential oils into the home. Can you get the benefits from it just by having it in the home environment? Mm-hmm. And for example, exposing yourself to essential oils overnight while you're sleeping has been found to have almost as much benefit for many of the endpoints that they're looking at in the forest in the home itself.
Yeah, amazing that those biometrics change, right? Yeah. As we do that, our body tends to adapt that natural environment, and everything kind of goes back into balance there.
Yes, yeah.
As we have that chemistry exposed
to our bodies. Sort of dampening of the sympathetic, rising of the parasympathetic, and sort of keeping control of that, all the homeostatic engines that we have.
I don't think it's any surprise to our audience, right, that nature, we resonate with nature. And this is one of those blends that really speaks to that resonating with nature and feeling better when we're exposed to natural things, natural environments, as well as, you know, natural essential oils.
No, absolutely. And there are measurable benefits that come from it.
Yeah. I love the Shinrin-Yoku blend. I really think that it's a powerful, powerful blend that we have
I know
created.
You've been working for this for a while. It's been a passion of yours.
It's been so exciting. I spent a lot of time in the mountains of Utah and the western United States, and I actually do spend, there are days in which I spend 24, 48, and sometimes a week long in the forest because I like to backpack, and that's really where my passion came from in developing the Shinrin-Yoku blend, because I feel better when I'm out in nature, and there are times where I need to go and escape to nature to reset, because our world is fast-paced. There's so many things going on, right? We live in urban environments more and more. I read a study that said 3% of the world population lived in cities in the 1800s.
It's now, like 10-15% now,
yeah,
isn't it?
It's really, by 2050, they expect it'll be 60%+ living in cities, and we just, we're not made to be in that environment. We're at odds with those environments. And so finding a time where we can, on a consistent basis, go be in nature is the ideal.
Yes.
When we can't, we have the beautiful Shinrin-Yoku blend to help us with.
And that. I think just having that blend is also just, even if it using that blend to take the time to say, it's just 5 minutes to say, we know how much meditation and mindfulness helps with, you know, your the levels of stress, and you can measure that within the blood with your cortisol levels and the adrenaline, your noradrenaline, that can really be measured within the blood, and you can see the differences that take place there. So using this as a tool to support those, I think, is just yet another fantastic product. So.
Well, Ruth, thank you for your time today. It's been a pleasure chatting with you.
Thank you for developing the blend. It's been going to be wonderful. I'm going to really enjoy using it.
Thank you.